Jeff, how long have you been working in morning news now?
Probably 2.5 years now.
Was that by choice or was that just the job that was offered?
That was the job that was offered.
Okay. Are you a morning person?
Yes. More than a night person.
Okay. People are one way or the other, I think, in our business.
Yeah, I think so.
My friend Stephanie, she works at the Weather Channel. Stephanie Abrams is going to be our guest today. She is not a morning person, which is interesting because she's the face of their morning weather coverage and has been for the last 15 years.
That's got to be fun.
Super challenging. So today, our theme is survival. How do you survive on a shift like that that you become known for when you're really not wired to be doing it? And then the other part of the survival is she has carved out this really interesting niche in terms of the way she looks at social media. And a lot of people are following what she does. She does not suffer the fools that are the trolls on the internet. So we'll learn a little bit about how she survives those things. And I'll tell you how the two of us met in the first place, which is kind of a funny story, too.
Sounds good.
So what are you dying to ask, Jeff?
I want to hear about survival in the field.
Yeah, you're into the tech part of it.
Yeah.
All right. And I want to hear about surviving the trolls, because that is a huge part of our business that, quite frankly, didn't exist when I got into this many, many years ago when Jeff was just a figment of his parents' imagination or something like that. Here's Stephanie Abrams.
Have you ever wondered, how did they do that? I'm talking about the art of the follow through. I'm Deirdre Fitzpatrick, and Dying to Ask is the podcast that gets me off a TV news set and into candid conversations with authors, entrepreneurs, and influencers I have been dying to talk to. So brace yourself. This is a verbal gut check about what it takes to go from idea to reality. And who knows, maybe along the way, you'll get some answers to questions you've been dying to ask.
Stephanie Abrams, thanks for joining us on the podcast.
I'm really thrilled to be here and, of course, be talking with you.
Oh, well, it's really fun. So let me ask you, what's the weather like where you are today?
Right, of course. Here we go.
Here we go.
It's rainy. How about where you are, though? I guess I should know that, right?
Well, one would think, but I think we kind of expect you to know what the weather's like everywhere.
Everywhere. That's the thing. The best is, like, I'm getting married in Iowa in 7 months. What's the weather going to be? It's like...
What do you say to that? What's your standard answer?
My standard answer is, you know, we're going to have to, it's a little too far out, but we'll have to check back a little bit later type of a thing. But yes, if I don't know the weather in every city in the entire country, every minute of every day, I'm like a total failure.
Right. You know, you're such a nicer person, because I would tire of that question and I would just be like, sunny and 70, you are golden. Book that baby.
Maybe that's what I should start doing, actually, just making up random, you know.
Exactly. But, you know, that's kind of the hazard of the job when you work in a place like the Weather Channel, because unlike our own meteorologists in individual cities, you're kind of expected to know everything. No pressure.
You really are. And by the way, not just about weather, you know, about any like science event, you know, like that you've ever heard of. Like, I've had mothers come up to me, their kids, oh, she's a meteorologist. So it's something about outer space. And I'm like, well, you know, I'll try to answer with my best guess. But the reality is, you know.
That's funny. How long have you been at the Weather Channel now?
So 15 years. I just had my anniversary last month.
And you've been on AMHQ for how long?
So a few years. I mean, I feel like I've been on every shift. You know, we're a 24-hour network. So no matter what, you kind of move around in shifts. So I've been on mornings now, though, for a really long time. I'm trying to think, it's probably 8, 9-ish, maybe longer years doing the morning shift, which, as you know,
yep,
is challenging, especially when you're not a morning person.
Which is interesting, because I definitely am, because to me, working nights is like nails on a chalkboard. I can't do it. I fall asleep by 9 o'clock. Yes, I
Only
could not
you've been
do
on
nights.
Mornings this long, or
no,
just you've never been a night person?
I just think that that's how I'm wired. I'm not a night person. I much prefer mornings. Although, that said, both Jeff and I don't get up in the morning. We get up in the middle of the night, I would say.
Yeah.
You know, so I'd say we're kind of like quasi that. But I think you are wired one way or the other. So for you to not be a natural morning person, how do you get around that?
It's painful. I mean,
yeah.
You basically, listen, life is really just a big mental game, is it not? I mean, that's really all it is a big mental game. And so, you know, I just work on that on the regular of like, I woke up on Monday, I had been on vacation for 10 days or something. And I woke up on Monday and I felt like depressed and sad and frustrated. I'm like, nope, snap out of this. Like, get over it. You know, you love your job. And you just have to talk yourself out of it.
Yeah.
I don't feel like working out, you know, I'm going to go work out after this. Well, I'm run down. And I'm like, you know what? You're going to do it. You're going to get over the hump and you're going to do it. You're going to over-talk and negative self-talk that says you're tired, you can't do it. And it's almost like kind of good training.
Yeah.
You know, is really for life.
When you're talking to yourself or trying to talk yourself out of something, do you talk out loud?
Sometimes. When
I go do too.
Now, I know you're a runner also.
Yes.
I don't know if you're both runners, but Deidre, I know you're a runner.
You know what? Hold on. Stand down. Jeff, are you a runner? We've never talked about this.
No. Not even close.
Only if you're chased.
Pretty much. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Back to the story.
I've literally been running and having conversations out loud. So I'm like, cut this out. Stop the negative self-talk. You can do this
yes.
out loud. And I'm assuming you have because I can see
yes.
your reaction too.
Yes, yeah. I do. And I will often, you know, my nickname is Fit. So I will often throw my name in there because talking to yourself in the third person is just that much more weird, just to add to the whole
Wait,
thing.
Wait, does Jeff ever talk to himself? Though I think that's more important. We need to know.
Jeff, what's the status of your mental health these days?
It's shaky, on shaky ground, I'd say.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't talk in the third person for sure.
You don't?
And I don't really talk to myself.
Yes.
Yeah.
But you know what? Jeff has an advantage on this because his wife is going through graduate school right now in counseling.
She does talk to herself, though.
She does.
Yes.
Maybe it's a
good
thing.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Wow, that just went a direction I didn't expect. We should explain how we know each other because it is the most random story ever. We have a mutual friend, another meteorologist, whose name is Amy Fries.
And that's her birth name.
That is her real, honest to goodness name. I've met Mr. and Mrs. Fries. It's the real deal. So Amy, I've known Amy for more than 20 years, and she works out of a station in New York City. And I went out to run the New York City Marathon with Amy a few years ago. And I met you holding a sign on the side of the road that said, "Unicorns run marathons." And you were the loudest, craziest person ever. I'm like, look at that woman. And Amy says, she goes, "Oh, that's Stephanie." I'm like, what? Not at all what I expected.
Yeah, and that's the thing. It's funny. I've been loud my entire life. It was, you know, even in grade school, you know, they used to write on your report card, your teacher, and they'd be like, "She's a great student, but you know, there was always that but.
Comma.
She talks too much. I had to move her, you know, away from people."
How about this one? Disruptive to others.
Right.
Did you ever get that?
To others.
I got that all the time.
I was that guy. And you know, what's even funny though, is like during marathons and stuff, I'm very excited. I'm very passionate. I think that'd be the best way to describe me is I'm just passionate, but I'm not wild. So like, yes, Deidre's like, "Oh my gosh, she's wild. She's screaming." But I'm not like in clubs, like on the bar dancing, you know, and doing that type of thing.
That's
like,
because you get up in the middle of the night. You can't stay awake
too, right?
By the time the club opens, just like me.
That is
very
true.
If the clubs opened at like 3:34 in the afternoon, I'd be there every day. It's just not happening.
No, it isn't.
No.
So they do have, next time you go to New York, they do have day clubs.
Do they really?
It's New York, yes, where they like start partying in the afternoon at like noon. And it's dark. There's glow sticks. I've never been. Amy Fries has been. Ask her about her day club experience. And my husband actually has been.
Wow, I am missing out on a whole... Maybe I am a club goer and I have no idea. I'm just in the wrong club. Yet another thing we're missing out on the West Coast.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's the story of how we met. And I just instantly adored you because you are what you see on TV trying to like rein the circus that is your morning show is what you're like in real life. And I will tell you, and Jeff will attest to that. Jeff's a photographer, by the way. Not all people on TV are what you think they are.
No.
In fact, I would say, I think more than half are not at all what they're really like.
Well, I agree with you. And this has been, and by the way, I instantly took to you as well, because again, you're just authentic. And I think that's what
I'm too tired to be anything else.
Well, that's true. I don't have the energy.
No, I don't have time for another persona. I'm exhausted.
I'm with you on that.
Yeah.
But, you know, growing up, a lot of people said, "Well, who inspired you in this and that?" And I remember watching Oprah, because who didn't watch Oprah growing up, right? Every day you couldn't miss her.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, I don't want to be Oprah. I don't want to be anyone else. But what I liked about her is she was authentic. And I knew people liked her because of her authenticity. And so from the get-go when I got into this business, which I didn't think I was going to go into, I was like, I'm just going to be me. And it's worked for me. And I do think people can tell when you don't really like someone on TV, I think it's because they're not being authentic.
Mm-hmm. I think it's interesting, though, because you can say I'm going to be me. But what has happened, at least to me in the past, is we have these talent coaches who come in and they usually change up every couple of years. And whatever the last person told you to do about your performance on television, the next person will tell you completely the opposite thing to do. And they will say things like,
not the current one we have now, but I'm just saying this is something I've heard in the past. We love what you're doing. We love you. We want that. Just a little less of you. I'm like, well, where does that leave me? I want half of it. There's no
this
such
is why
thing.
We
I know.
I have the same things are told to me. It was like, let's just pull back a little bit. Rein it in. I get the rein it in, you know, type of a thing. And I get what they're saying, you know, and sometimes I do and sometimes I don't. But they always say, we'd rather tell you to rein it in than have to push you. And I'm like, no one has to push me. I will volunteer to do everything and anything at any point. So I get the same thing you do. And I guess that's
yes.
why, you know.
This is probably why we get along. But it's kind of like that same person will almost every time say, we want to think outside of the box. Just not today.
Yeah.
It's a weird business.
Yeah.
What's the worst advice you ever got from someone about your performance on TV?
Oh my gosh. I've never actually gotten really bad advice. I mean, I've gotten really good advice actually from the people in my experience. And one of them was, you know, we do a lot of live shots for the Weather Channel with all the different weather around the country. And I actually think this works for live shots and in studio was I tend to talk fast, talk a lot. When you're doing a live shot, you want to tell 4,000 things in a minute and a half, and it's impossible. So the best advice I ever got was you're allowed to talk about three facts and walk and talk and show me something. Those were the best. That's the best advice I ever got, you know? And so I never really got any bad advice, actually. I guess.
Or maybe you didn't listen.
Well,
because
I can't rule that out either. Just
because you were talking.
That's very possible.
Yes.
That's very, very possible.
Tell us a little bit about what the Weather Channel is like, because it's certainly, like the rest of our business, has evolved over the years. And I'm curious to know, like, from the time you started, how has your job changed? Like, what's a typical day like these days?
You know, it's changed a lot in the fact that, well, now there's the whole social media aspect, which everyone's dealing with in every company. It's not even just our business, right? It's like even, you know, for all these deals when it was like avocado day, it was like Chipotle would give you free guac, but only if you did it online or on the app. So it's not just our business. It's everyone being affected by it. So that is definitely different where you're doing podcasts like this, or you're doing stuff on Instagram and, you know, Insta Google Tweet Face, as my husband calls it. You know, there's that
That's
aspect
of awesome.
It.
Insta yeah. Google Tweet Face.
He is not a social media guy. And I'm actually pretty private on my social media. I really just do work stuff. But he's like, oh, are you going to put that on Insta Google Tweet Face?
Oh my
you
God,
know?
I love him already.
Yeah,
that's fantastic.
I can't wait for you to meet him one day.
I know.
But just over the years, just, you know, the way that you are kind of telling the stories and, you know, we've gotten back in the day, we used to stack all of our own shows. Now we have weather producers to help. And, you know, it's really evolved in a very fascinating way, I think.
You know what's interesting about the Weather Channel, and I don't want this to sound bad, so I'm going to preface it with, I love everything you guys do. But back in the day, the stereotype of the people watching the Weather Channel was much older, and people who sat and wanted to watch nothing but the forecast all day long. And what you do now is so not that. I mean, it's
yeah.
storytelling, it's journalism,
graphic.
It's technology, it's science, it's all those other things. Is that a fair criticism of how just what you guys do has really changed and evolved
yes,
as our
no.
needs
okay,
have?
I will expand on that. Yes. First
okay.
of all, you wouldn't believe, that's definitely a stereotype, because you wouldn't believe the type of people that are like, psst, psst, hey, Steph, I love watching the Weather Channel. I'm like, why do you have to even care? Like, okay, if you're, you know, 20 years old and you like to watch the Weather Channel, like, relax, A.
I'm not a secret. I won't be hidden.
I won't be hidden. No one can save me in the corner.
Jeff, did you know that KCRA3's Leticia Ordaz likes musicals?
I did not know that.
You know how I knew that?
How do you know that?
KCRA app,
what?
News team bios. It's one of the fun features you'll find on the app in addition to your news, your weather. I know you love the weather.
Weather's very important.
Super important to Jeff. He needs to know what to wear in the morning. Sartorial splendor, that is his thing. KCRA app, it is free. It's like having KCRA in your pocket. And if you enable those push notifications, you find out breaking news as we know it.
That sounds great.
Well, go get it.
I will.
So, I'm opposite of Deirdre in many respects.
In every way.
So I don't watch the Weather Channel regularly, mostly because I don't have cable. But you know, I just it's not on my radar. No pun intended.
Wow, that was I'm saving that one up.
But I will say that I have seen a lot of the immersion. pieces. They'll show up on my Facebook or on my, well, whatever social media I'm on.
Instagram tweet face.
Yeah, exactly. And that's just so cool. Like, there was one that was done with a tornado in the room, and like, I want to hear more about that.
Well, you know, the interesting thing about it is what we're trying to do is really get all of our graphics like that, where it's augmented reality, immersion, you know, the graphics are all around you, the story's all around you. That's really the goal and the end point. Right now, though, it takes several days of rehearsals for the on-camera meteorologist and also our cameraman in studio to rehearse all of those. But it is definitely worth it because I think you stop in your tracks, like you said, you know, to kind of watch it. And then you might maybe learn something, you know, as a takeaway on this as well, which is really the ultimate goal, right? To help people and save people and get them prepared. So
has that stuff then changed who watches you guys? Because to me, it's somebody who's, people these days to me are seeking out the content that they want to learn about. That's what I love about podcasts. You listen because you want to learn something. You're an active participant. So to me, I would think that the people who are watching you guys these days, they want to know why is it happening, not just that it's going to happen or that it did happen.
Right. And I hope so. I hope it brings more people in, because I think in the 3D, and I was always the kid in school asking 8 million questions if you were in class with me, and everyone's embarrassed to do that. And I was like, I have no shame in my game. I don't know what you're talking about. Like, and by the way, 99.9% of the other people in the class have no idea either.
Right.
You know? And so I kind of took that. I was a TA before I started at the Weather Channel in college. And I realized, like, you have to be entertaining, and you have to tell things in layman terms. Like, I always say that the atmosphere is like a hamburger, you know, and I talk about the different layers you have to look at to figure out what the weather's going to be. Just this week, we're talking about all the rain that we've had along the East Coast. And I'm like, you know, it's like you have a wet sponge just sitting there. It sits there. And yeah, it's wet, there's a little water around it, but if you have someone to wring it out like this front's gonna do, you're gonna get a lot more water out of the sponge, or like a mountain range. So I think that these graphics will help me present better, articulate better, and hopefully the viewer understand better.
So the graphics are awesome in studio, but my favorite, and I think most viewers' favorites, is when you are out there like hanging onto the pole because the hurricane's about to take you away. You know, you got that Wizard of Oz kind of feel to the whole thing. Let's talk a little bit about the live element, because the Weather Channel, as much as we do it in local news, you guys really perfected the art form of being out in the storm while telling people to take shelter so that we can really see and experience what it's really like.
Yeah. And I actually think, you know, they have 3D TVs now. I think they should do 4D. So when we're out in like a storm, the weather actually spits out of your television.
Yes. I love that.
The rain, or like the wind. Like,
you can throw a snowball at us and just like smack us in the face with it.
And it will actually come through the television. Like, they'll have snow like in the back of your TV, and it like sprays out at you.
It's going to be amazing. Get on that, Jeff. Make it happen.
Make it happen, Jeff. You can get on that, right? So, you know, the thing about the Weather Channel is everyone there is a meteorologist and they love the weather. They're doing it for the weather and not for the TV. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's where we're unique, you know, than a lot of places perhaps, is because we want to go in the weather and we want to do it. So we're out there like a kid in a candy shop, just like talking about our experience, what we're seeing, what we're doing. We're so passionate about it. That is our Super Bowl. And so I think that's why, you know, we're not like, you have to go. We're not like, I don't want to go. I mean, that is where we want to be in it. We understand it better. We can articulate better. We know what the viewer's going through better. It's not glamorous. You know, I'm eating Pop-Tarts and, you know, squatting in the corner to go to the bathroom just like everyone else is at home when they're in these situations.
Yeah. What, when the big weather comes up, is there like a ferocious game of Rochambeau between you guys on who gets to go to it? Because here we always joke about it's the short straw. But I would imagine there you guys are like throwing each other under the bus to get to that storm.
Yes. Well, you see, there's a mud pit in one of our studios.
I knew it. You know, I knew it.
Yeah, exactly. It's So no, I mean, the reality is a lot of it depends on like what shift you're on. But yeah, and the reality is when there's a storm, everyone's going out. Whether you like, it doesn't matter. We're all going out because, you know, that is really our job, to protect people before, during, and after storms and help them through it. So, you know, we're all basically chomping at the bit to go out.
From a physical and technical standpoint, what's the hardest type of weather to produce weather coverage in?
Ooh, that's a really good question, because there's a little something with each of them. I mean, with hurricanes, obviously the wind-driven rain, you need shelter for the, Jeff can attest, you know, the camera gear and everything. They can't be out in the weather. We can stand out there for hours, but obviously the camera stuff can't. When you're in the cold, they can stand out in it, but the batteries go. And like every second you have to change your batteries. So it really is depends on what event you're covering, the different challenges, because obviously technology and weather do not mix.
No. What kinds of people are drawn to be photographers at the Weather Channel? I mean, they must, like the rest of us, have a little bit of a screw loose, because that's really hard work every
well,
day.
Well, Jeff, would you ever do it? Are you, would you like to be in it, doing the weather?
I don't know if I could do that full time. No. I enjoy it when I do it from time to time here, but when I have 2 weeks straight of standing in the snow and saying that it's cold, I'm just like, okay, let's. I'm ready for something else now.
You get a little grumpy. You're like, yeah. Oh, that podcast doesn't sound so bad now.
Exactly.
Yeah. And, you know, there are some photographers where I'm like, are you sure you want to go out in the storm with us? You know, are you prepared for this? And they were like, heck yeah, we love it. So yeah, I do think that we tend to stick with those photographers that are, you know, like us and really excited and amped for it. You kind of have to be, or you won't survive, is the reality. Because when there's a hurricane, you're going for days. Yeah. Straight. So you have to love it. You have to enjoy it, or you're not going to make it.
You have to find fun in things like that, because those assignments, they look amazing on TV. The reality of how that sausage is made is horrendously disappointing to most people who see it up close.
Yeah, and I told them they should do like a reality show of how it really works.
Yeah.
You know, behind the scenes where, you know, there's been times when I've had to drive from Tallahassee to Key West or whatever it was, Miami, you know, like in one day, and then get on air like the second you get down there. There's no hair and makeup. The electricity goes out. We have flashlights too, just like everyone else. I don't shower for days. I mean, wear the same clothes, you know, that's the reality of it. It is not as glamorous. We are going through exactly what the people are there.
What are some of the weirder things you've had to do on one of those extended shoots?
Well, there's been, sleeping in cars. There's been a lot of that activity before. Or like sleeping upright on a couch or using the restroom in very odd places.
Yes. Can we just say it's good to be a man? Mm-hmm. On those
shoots. Listen, I've got it down though, Deidre. It's all about a garbage bag and a quick corner. You're good. Like, I've got it down. I mean, yeah. We were stuck once in a, like, were you parking garage? And we were stuck where the elevator part was. Literally all night, like, there's nothing you can do. It's like, okay, everyone, you go on that side, turn your back. I'm going to take a garbage bag and go over here, because that was our only option. Literally, yes. You could not get out of the door because the winds were so strong, and where are you going to go anyway?
You know, you can always tell a newer reporter when you're nodding, you know where I'm going to go with this, where they feel that they need to find like a nice Denny's or something. I'm like, you need to get over that.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with a porta potty.
I had a reporter once who made me stop at 3 different bathrooms on the way to a school shooting. Yeah.
Are you serious?
I'm dead serious.
Because
they weren't good enough.
Yeah. Is that person still in the business?
No,
probably not.
She's not.
For multiple reasons.
It's interesting you say that, because I will like dehydrate myself. You know, if I'm on air for like 12 hours and you know, you like, there's not really a bathroom close. Like, we mm-hmm. always try to get to a bathroom, but sometimes there isn't. So sometimes I would literally be like, literally dehydrate myself. And when I get off air, I don't feel great. And then chug water after, because it's just, sorry, it's what it is, you know?
It's survival. Mm-hmm. It's survival. So all of these things, I think, will ensure that many people do not want to go into our field as we describe the realities of what it's like to be on TV. The other thing that is somewhat distracting to some people, or detracting, is the fact, and you alluded to this earlier, that we now, as television people, have become a brand, which when we were both starting out in this, was not even on the radar. The idea that a person would be a brand versus the place they worked for was unheard of.
It was. And that is a tough, it's definitely a challenge for me, because at first I was very open, because you don't really know, you don't really understand when it was first coming out. But now I'm just really, really protective of my life for several reasons, you know, because in this business, you know, not everyone on social media is nice or out with the best intentions. And so I like to protect myself. With that said, you know, I'm not fazed, though a lot of people are. My self-worth does not depend on what people post on my social media. Like, it just doesn't. So what I always say is, like, my Insta Google tweet face is not a democracy.
I love this.
I'm all for constructive criticism. It's cool if I have a crutch word I've said 55 times in my show. Hey, Abrams, you know, you happen to be saying this a lot. Just wanted to point it. No big deal, but whatever. But they're like, you're dumb because you said this 55 times. Guess what? Delete, ban. Like, done, I don't care. So there are, and I don't understand this, where people get on Twitter wars with people they don't even know, or even people they do know. I'm like, to me, like, I feel bad for those people, because obviously they're in pain if they feel that they need to, like, engage with somebody who obviously is having their own pain and taking it out on you. I feel bad for everyone, because I just go, oh, delete, move on. Like,
well, and I love that you're so blunt with people. You're like, you were deleted because and you're gone. Like, you're off the island. You're done. Did you learn that, though, the hard way? Because what, yes, I recall when all this was starting off, and I remember talking to our friend Amy Fries about that, because she was the queen of all of this before any of the rest of us were doing it. She saw all of this stuff early. But I remember talking to her, and it's very difficult, I think, to separate sometimes your kind of public persona and value in that persona and social media outreach with, you know, having a real life and actual real tangible relationship. So how did you learn that? How'd you navigate it? And how did you get burned along the way? Because I'm guessing you, like me, got burned.
I did. And I used to get so upset. I would get upset when people would say the meanest things to me. And not only on social media, just on the internet, whatever. I would get so upset and so bothered. I think it's an age thing. I think it's a confidence thing. I think it's a me working on myself thing in the end. It's me knowing that if someone's acting nasty to you, and this goes for everybody, even if you're not on Insta, Google, Tweetface, if you run into someone at the grocery store or wherever, if someone's being nasty to you, it's because something is going on in their life and they're, you know, manifesting all of that and putting on, it has nothing to do with me. And so I think it's me just, you know, learning all of this by practice. And even to this day, I still have to practice. Like, you go, you know, you talk to someone, they're nasty to you. I'm like, okay, hang on a second, Steph. Like, you got to go back with them with calm. Don't, you know, engage, you know, type of a thing. And it just makes life so much better.
Did you, as a woman in this business, find it hard to have real relationships, even outside of Insta, Google, Tweetface? But did you find that was a difficult thing, especially with as much travel as you've done and having a much more national platform as a job? What are the challenges that you've run into there?
You're so intimidating. If I had a penny for every time I said, I'm like, Deidre, you know me. I mean, Jeff, I don't know, you've met for 30 minutes.
Like, I feel like he knows you, though. I mean, like,
we're tight. Yeah. I don't think I'm intimidating, right? But nobody does, right? But I don't show up. I mean, you see me, Deidre. I show up like ponytail shorts.
Yeah.
Like, I don't see myself. And again, I see myself as a meteorologist. I love the science. I have a minor in math. Like, I didn't go into TV for TV. So I don't. I'm not into things. I don't wear like, my purse is from Target. I drive a Prius. Like, I'm just not interested. So the fact that people think I'm intimidating, again, that's their own thing. And that's why, you know, all these years of trying to date, I just got married, you know, I'm almost 40. It's like, people are like, oh, well, you're intimidating and men are intimidated. I'm like, okay, well, I need to meet someone who's not intimidated by me, because I'm really not scary. I'm as basic as they come.
Not scary much. Scary-ish. So when you meet, you know, some of the, maybe the younger meteorologists coming in, especially the women, do you now, because you are so comfortable and you've kind of navigated this crazy world, do you find yourself offering them advice on how to kind of, because I know that I do, although I wait to be asked more. I don't try to offer it up as much as maybe I might have before. But sometimes I look at it, I'm like, let me save you some trouble here. Let me save you a little heartache and help you find some, you know, balance in all of this. Because they only know the world of being a brand and being on social media, which I am so grateful to have not had that experience in my 20s. Because quite honestly, Jeff, and you don't know this about me, because you know me as like wife and mom of two kids, I wouldn't still be here if people knew about some of the things in my 20s. I had fun, but nobody had to know about any of these things.
I know. And I think this goes, again, for everyone in our business and outside, because I feel like everyone's a brand now, right? Mm-hmm. I don't think it's just people in the media, and I don't think it's just people that are on YouTube. Everyone is a brand now. And by the way, the employers see that, the whole thing. So yes, I agree with you on that. And I always tell, again, people in this business or any business, and I honestly, you guys can agree or not agree, I'm not sure. I think it comes with age, which is unfortunate, but I try to say
it is, isn't it?
I mean, so it's so mean. Frustrating. It's like, if I just could have been more confident in my 20s, in my 30s, you know, and been more comfortable in my skin, I would have saved myself a lot of tears, a lot of heartache, you know, with dating guys, with everything. It just would have been so much, but I think it's an age thing. Do you agree or not agree?
I 100% agree. And I look back at pictures from my 20s, and it breaks my heart that I thought I didn't look good.
Jeff's face right now. Why am I in this girl talk?
He's getting very uncomfortable right now. I kind of like it. But no, but I mean, there's got to be something you relate to with this, Jeff. I mean, I'm sure we'll find it in a minute. But I guess my point is, I look back at things at the beginning of my career, and I remember feeling less than. And I look back and I think that's really kind of sad because I wasn't less than. I actually was doing a pretty darn good job. And I had some good stuff going on.
Do you ever do that now? And this is just being totally vulnerable and open, where I have to take myself off of social media because I'll look at Instagram and be like, well, my life's not that good. And it's like, are you kidding me, Abrams? Like, yeah, it is. But your mind plays tricks on you, right? Your negative self-talk is like, oh, well, you don't have this and you don't have that and your trip wasn't this and that. And so it even messes with me, and I'm pretty comfortable and confident with where I am right now. So, you know, if there's a way to learn that earlier or try to help kids that are younger to figure that out, I'd love to. But I think as a human, unfortunately, right, you say learn from your parents or elderlies or whatever, but we just have to go through stuff to learn it, which is just part of being a human.
I think that's really true. And I do think that, like, with the social media stuff, I think it's really important to take breaks. I think you got to take a time out. And I think that we'll look back at all of this in 20 years, or we're going to know, probably from Jeff's wife and all of her studies, we're going to know the negative impact a lot of these things have on us. And the fact that we have this kind of like, what's the word, curated environment, this curated sense of self. I mean, if I posted family or kid-related photos of what really happens in my day, you would A, lose your mind, or B, think, she's a hot mess, you know, because that's what real life is like.
Yeah, but this is not something new. Because if you go back before social media, everyone would do it, even when we were kids. Our parents would go out and be like, yay, smile, my kids are fed and their lunches are packed. Now they said it, now it's just on social media. So now it's just a different way of getting that. So it's like not much really has changed, just the way we're getting that information is different. You know, because people are still trying to keep up with everybody else, you know, back in the day before social. You know, keeping up with the Joneses with, oh, my kids are impeccably dressed and their lunches are packed and the homework's done and I'm happy and my husband and I have a great relationship. Like, you know, it's just a different outlet now, I think.
Yeah, no, I think that's really true. I think it's true. So what's your best advice for people who are coming into your business or getting into maybe thinking about getting into doing what you do? What do you tell them they need to know?
Well, you know, and again, I think this applies to our business and all business. If you find what you're passionate in, then it changes your life. They say, oh, you haven't worked a day in your life, you know, when you love what you're doing. But if you're going into TV especially, you have to love what you're doing because of the hours and the grind, you know, and everything else. You have to love it. And I think that really goes across the board. And again, across the board, it's a confidence thing. If I could teach people self-worth at a young age, and I wish there was a way, you know, I kind of want to do like this whole speaking tour because the reality is you have to do the work in your head. You have to do the work. It doesn't just come. If I knew I had to do the work and what work I had to do in my 20s, then I think it would have been different. But no one told me, like, I have to fight my negative self-talk. And you have to do things that are uncomfortable. And no one was standing right by me like, no, walk through that pit of fire because it's going to feel better on the other side. Like, that is what I think is so important in life.
Gosh, that's really good.
It's good.
It's really good. You did something as a kid that I dreamed of doing.
Base camp.
Yep.
It's space camp. How amazing was that?
You can go as an adult, by the way, Deidre. Maybe I can hook you up with my people if you want to go, or bring your kids down. I think they do like a family space camp. So let me know, seriously.
Seriously, there's family space camp?
Yeah, I think there is. I think you can still go down there. I'm pretty sure. I could be wrong.
How instrumental was that in turning you into somebody who was interested in science, and especially as a woman, where there's such a huge push these days, and I know this is one of your passions, to get girls into science and STEM learning?
You know, I was fortunate that I had a dad. My dad basically raised me, and he was very much into math and science. And so as a kid, Halley's Comet came by. He took his telescope out. He'd show us the moon. You know, so I had that influence. He took us to Yellowstone for a trip. So he was science-oriented. He's a physician. And then when we were really little, he sent my sister and I to space camp in Florida, because that's where I was raised, and then to Alabama for sleepaway for a week. And it was just, you know, I think it was like, it's like as a parent, right? Like, you'd be like, oh, you'll love this. Go. So I think it was kind of one of those things where my dad kind of wanted to go, like, you know, and was like, well, my kids will go. I'll live through them type of a thing.
Or I'll get a week off. I just sent my kid away to camp.
That too.
There's that. Trust me.
Okay. Thanks for breaking my heart. But yeah, no, I'm just kidding. I thought my dad wanted to experience it with us. Really, he just wanted time to himself.
Well, sometimes they meet in the middle, Steph. It's all good.
Okay. So anyway.
Daddy loves you. You're fine.
I know. So anyway, he sent us, and I really latched onto that. And all the science stuff he did with us as kids, just really, my sister, she's into music. She's a middle school music teacher. I mean, she enjoyed it, but not like I did. So I think really with children, exposing them, right? He put us in dance. He put us in science stuff. He put us in everything. And then whatever your kids latch onto. And that was what I latched onto. My sister latched onto the music aspect that he had put us into. So yeah, that's how it kind of came about.
Show them and inspire them.
Yeah, it was really cool though.
What do you still want to do? Like what's, you mentioned speaking and sharing some of your story. Like what's out there that you still really think, gosh, I really want to try that?
So I'm really passionate about mind-gut interaction and how food, you know, is your medicine. And I don't think people really so I'd love to get involved in that. I'd love to get involved and write a book, but it'd be me opening up and being vulnerable, which is a tough thing to do. And I'm not sure how much I want to share and not share, because it really, my journey doesn't really matter. Because what I think really matters is, and like I said before, it's doing the work. It's when that negative self-talk, that negative ego, as Eckhart Tolle talks about, pops up in your mind, you have to override it. You have to do the work or nothing's going to change in your life. And it goes from doing the dishes to work, to relationships, you have to override it. So I'm constantly fighting my negative self-talk. We all have it. Jeff, I know you do too. You know, we all have those feelings, and then we eat too much or we don't eat enough or, you know, and so I would love to really explain this all to people and help them do the work.
The last time I saw you in person, it was after the marathon. I was at your apartment. Thank you for letting me take a shower. On behalf of everyone on the plane, the red eye that I took back from New York that night. But you do something that I do, and I remember walking out of your bathroom and like screaming, I was so excited. You love post-it notes.
Yes.
And you just mentioned Eckhart Tolle. You love motivational quotes and post-its, and you had them all over your mirror. I loved that because I have done that.
Yeah, all over my house. And here's the thing is what I've learned also is I listen to a lot of things on YouTube, and I listen to Eckhart Tolle's book on tapes when I'm on planes and all these things. There's one thing to listen to it. And it's one thing to go to all these speakers who amp you up and hype you up, right? And we all know the people we're talking about. But if you don't do the work on the daily, none of this matters. And so that for me was a real, you know, as Oprah says, aha moment, is that just like to go to the gym, to eat healthy, eat clean, go to the gym, you have to work your brain. You have to. And so I don't think people understand how imperative that, you know, when you're waiting at, you start little. Right? You're waiting for the elevator and it's taking too long. You start getting frustrated. I'm going to be late. Blah, blah, blah. I'm stressing out. I'm not going to be there. It's like, you know what? This is a great time for me to practice patience. You know what? I'm just going to enjoy the flowers. Oh, look at the reflection in the elevator. Look, all of a sudden, you know? So you have to do the work. You start little and you get bigger and bigger and bigger with everything in your life.
I love that. Do the work. All right. We need to wrap up because I know that there's like some forecast or front that's coming in and you got to go start, you know, dealing with that. What are the best ways for people to keep up with you? We know your husband's not keeping up with you on the Google
nope,
and Snapchat.
He absolutely is not. No.
But for the rest of the world, trolls excluded, how do we keep up with you?
Listen, the trolls can too, because it lets me practice my self-worth. Like, this person's not defining me. It's okay.
You are so positive. I love it.
Well, Deidre, this is a lot of work, and this is not every day. You caught me on a good day. but that's the truth of it. So, you know, Instagram, I'm Stephanie Abrams. Also on Twitter, Stephanie Abrams. And then Facebook, Stephanie Abrams. There's an official site with a little blue check and everything. But that's the best way, I think, really.
And then weekdays on AMHQ. You never know where you'll
Monday
be.
Yeah, Friday, 6 to 9, East Coast.
We'll see you then. Stephanie, thanks so much.
Yes, thank you. Jeff, so nice meeting you. Deidre, I hope I see you soon.
What'd you think of Stephanie?
She was interesting.
She's really cool.
Yeah.
You are one of the few people who could get away with admitting that you don't watch her on television and then proceeding to have a really great interview with her.
I was a little nervous at first, but I'm like, no, this should be okay.
No, you just went there. You went honest, which shows you, like she said, live your life, do the work, be honest, and good things will happen.
Yeah. Authenticity.
Authenticity. Can't fake it.